Artificial intelligence, AI, and its application. This talk is divided into three parts. Part one, basics of AI and its applications. Part two, AI in national security. And part three, AI related capacity of PIAS. So we have three parts of this talk, okay? Basics of AI and its applications, AI in national security, and AI related capacity of PIAS. Now, before starting the basics of AI, let me tell you that there are a few initiatives, national initiatives on AI, like the President Initiative on AI, which comprises of basic courses on IoT, AI, and blockchain. And then we have the Prime Minister AI Task Force, which is related to project-oriented infrastructure, and it is based in Lahore as well as in Karachi. And then the National Center for AI, NCAI, and it consists of 9 AI labs in different universities, and this is supported by HEC, Higher Education Commission of Pakistan, as well as Planning Commission of Pakistan. Okay, so we start with the part one, basics of AI, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and then deep neural networks. So basically, AI is a broad field. Artificial intelligence, then machine learning is a subpart of AI, and then deep neural networks, DNN, is a subpart of machine learning. So the chronology or timeline of AI, so in early 1950s, it started, the concept of AI came into existence, okay, and then in 1980s, machine learning begins to flourish, and in 2010, deep learning has a boom. And through many of the breakthroughs that it received. Okay. So very briefly, what is AI? The ability of a machine to perform cognitive functions associated with human mind. And these consist of perceiving, reasoning, learning, and problem solving. So this is a general definition of AI, and there could be even more definitions of AI. Very briefly, what is machine learning? Machine learning provides computers with the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. Okay. So in machine learning, typically we have two phases, training phase and testing phase. In the training phase, we give the label data to the machine learning algorithm, and that algorithm is turned into a trained model, and we call it a learned machine learning model. Once the model is learned, we give it the unseen data and we analyze its prediction. So this phase is called as the testing. Major types of machine learning: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. In supervised learning, we usually give the label data, and then through these examples, the machine learning model is trained. In unsupervised, we give such examples which have no labels, okay, and there is no teacher to train, okay. So this is called unsupervised learning, and basically clustering is a type of unsupervised learning technique. Then we have reinforcement learning, which is based on reward strategy. Okay? And this is useful for policy optimization, specifically in robotics, where an agent performs action, takes a step or action in the environment. We monitor the environment, and based on its step, we give it a reward. Okay, and then the next state is predicted. ML application areas, there are largely four application areas of machine learning: classification task, then we have regression task, anomaly detection task, and clustering. In classification, it's very easy. We have, for example, an image or text, and we want to classify it in two classes or even in many classes. Then in regression, we simply regress the data. In clustering, we have the input data, and we want to cluster the input data into groups. And in anomaly detection, it basically learns the anomaly. It is able to detect the anomaly by learning the normal signal, okay, or the pattern of the normal signal. So whenever an anomaly comes, it is going to alarm us. Now, just to give you a machine learning example, in this table, in the first column, we have the type of application. In the second column, we have the input for that application. And in the third column, the decision taken by the machine learning algorithm. So if we start with this application, like the target detection, okay, so the input is picture, or image, and the decision to take is that, is this a target? The machine learning algorithm is going to tell us, is this a target? Then in wind power prediction, we have meteorological parameters such as temperature, humidity, wind speed, etc. And we want to know the expected power. In case of preventive maintenance, we have sensory data from hard disk, plane, engine, etc. And the ML algorithm is going to tell us, is it about to fail or not? Similarly, in self-driving cars, we have camera and other sensors, and collision avoidance and path planning is performed. Now, for small-scale problems, we say machine learning, trivial machine learning algorithms are fine. But when we talk about complex problems demand higher level of learning. And for that, we need to use deep learning. Okay. So whenever we have a big data problem, like millions of images, okay, so the problem becomes complex. The classification or regression becomes complex. And for such a big data problem, deep learning is suitable. So what is deep learning? Very briefly, it's a type of ML that is more suitable for big data problems, like complex problem. And due to its deep and hierarchical learning mechanism, it can often produce more accurate results than traditional ML techniques. So the thing to learn is that whenever we have a simple machine learning problem, okay, we need to use the trivial conventional machine learning approach. But when we have a deep learning problem, a very complex and big data problem, only then we need to use deep learning. Okay. So deep learning basics, a deep neural network consists of a hierarchy of layers of neurons, whereby each layer transforms the input data into more abstract representation for the output layer to make prediction. So this, you can see that this is a human brain is shown, and the visual cortex, the part of the brain which is supposed to process the vision related signal, okay, it also has different segments, okay, and the signal is processed like from V1 to V2, V3, and then a decision is made. So similar on this natural concept of the different segments of the visual cortex of the human brain, deep convolutional neural network architectures, which is a specific type of neural network, is built. For example, we have a cat image, an input, okay, and then this image is transformed layer by layer, okay, and then we extract different types of feature. At the end, we are going to predict the category that this object is a cat. Okay, so briefly, what are neural networks? It's a collection of simple mathematical units performing complex functions. These mathematical units are called the neurons, artificial neurons. So we have the input layer, the hidden layer, and the output layer. Okay. And in between, we have links between the neurons, and each link has a weight. So if somebody asks you that how we train these neural networks, so you have to tell them that the weights of the links are basically optimized during the training. Okay. Once we have these optimized weights, we say that the neural network is trained, and now we can use it on unseen data. Another thing is that the number of hidden layers actually represents the depth of the deep neural network. If a neural network has three layers, we may call it a shallow architecture. But if it has, let's suppose, 10 or more than 10 layers, we may call it a deep neural network architecture. And it's a general rule. It's not hard and fast rule. It's a general rule that when we increase the depth, representation ability of the neural network increases. Now we come to applications of deep learning, okay, some generic application. And just to tell you that deep learning is becoming very famous. It is not only used in computer science and electrical engineering, but it is used in biochemistry, in bioinformatics, in physics, in chemistry, in chemical processing, in mechanical engineering, and many different fields. So deep learning application in computer vision. For example, if we want to train such a deep neural network, which can by itself annotate the input image, okay? So for this, the research has trained a deep vision CNN. CNN convolution neural network is very good for image processing, or you can say that data with data of discrete nature, like time series data. So they train a deep convolution neural network to process this image, and then they trained recurrent neural network for language generation. So these two are used in combination. Once these are used, so for example, they are given this image as a test image, and the network is asked to automatically learn this image, the content of this image, and then write whatever it has learned. So see, it says about this image, a group of people shopping at an outdoor market, and there are many vegetables at the fruit stand. So what it means that the network was able, it is as intelligent that it was able to not only pick the objects, the different objects in the image, the content of the image, but also it stated it in form of a text. Similarly, in this case, in this image, a close-up of a child holding a stuffed animal. Now this text is output of the neural network, not written by a human. So another interesting application is Google's AI beats human player. So Google's DeepMind beats human champion Lee Sedol in 2016 in the famous and very complex Go game, which is more difficult as compared to chess. And recently in 2019, Google AI beats top human players at strategy game StarCraft 2. Another application, AI controlled solar oven. So as you can see from the image that there are many different solar panels, and they have to be focused as the sun moves, they have to be focused. So each might be rotated a little differently. So if we have 100 or 1000 of such panels, so we need an intelligent control algorithm which can simultaneously rotate these so that the focus is not lost. So AI is used to synchronize the field of mirrors and thus focuses sunlight to generate extreme heat about 1000 degrees centigrade. Similarly, machine learning has been used at CERN, High Energy Physics Institute. So here, high energy physics researchers have been using ML techniques since the 1990s. The Higgs ML challenge is a very important challenge, and this was based on three types of events, like event selection, track reconstruction, and jet classification. Similarly, deep learning has been used for anomaly detection in nuclear reactors, so as to note whether there is a fault in any material of the nuclear reactor. Okay, images are taken and the fault is analyzed, and then the neural network can raise alarm, if it notes any anomaly before the the material breaks. It can tell us in advance that the material is going to break and you need to replace it. Similarly, predicting disruptive instabilities in controlled fusion plasmas through deep learning. So the fusion reaction, or we say that the tokamak, where the fusion reaction takes place, we usually want to have controlled fusion reaction over there. But mostly the plasma of the ionized particle that is out of control. So for this, to early detect the instabilities. ये अपने माइक बंद कर ले जरा. So to detect the instabilities in the controlled fusion plasma, even deep learning has been used. Now we come to the second part of this talk, which is AI in national security. And the first heading is AI arms race. We know that global AI arm race has already been started. And you might know that Putin, the Russian president, in 2017, gave this very important statement that the nation that leads in AI will be the ruler of the world. Similarly, AI in the future conflict. So this particular statement was given by a director of the NASA. So this shows us the importance of the AI as a technology. And in this context, it is imperative to have effective AI research and development strategy. AI in national security. So in this particular part 2, we are going to discuss current global use of AI in national security, as well as identification of potential disruptive and transformative applications. Focus areas of AI for national security, existing AI infrastructure and capabilities, and the way forward. Now, AI as a transformative technology. Nuclear technology was once considered as a transformative technology, and it did transform the shape of the politics, international politics. Now, after nuclear technology, artificial intelligence and cybersecurity are the two technologies that are considered as transformative and disruptive technologies. So transformative technology means that a technology that can transform the human world, yeah, and we can take benefit out of this transformation for good thing. For example, predicting failures of machine well before the machine breaks, target identification, automatic decision making, or common operating pictures like land, air, sea, space, cyberspace, and etc. So information, or you can say images, input from all these different sources is combined and given to the commanders of the battlefield, and they can make a prompt decision based on so much information in one common operating picture. AI can also be used for intelligence, surveillance, and prediction of future events. Now, AI is also considered as a disruptive technology. By disruptive, we mean that such a technology which actually replaces the current technologies, trivial technologies, and disrupt the current technology. So AI-based cyber war is already becoming very famous, and specifically AI-based malware analysis, where advanced persistent threat, it's a very advanced type of malware that can stalk and wait for a mistake. They are not only generated through the help of AI, but can also be detected and thwarted. So then again, a very interesting application is swarm of drones, whereby ultra-cheap 3D printed mini drones are controlled through AI. And suppose that these mini drones are in number of, let's suppose, 1,000, okay? So their control is very difficult, and their maneuver and their path planning is very difficult, but still AI is going to control them, and they are some of them basically reaches the target. So this particular problem is called intelligent coordination and control. Then lethal autonomous weapon system LAS, whereby the system identifies a target, employs onboard weapon system, that is, it can engage by itself without human assistance. So just to show you some glimpses of a swarm of drones, okay? So there could be even 100 or 1,000 of such drones, and controlling them is very difficult, but AI is very suitable for controlling them. Specifically, the deep reinforcement learning policy optimization is good for such control. These are lethal autonomous weapon systems. Some of them are drones, and some of them are some other autonomous vehicles. Now, what are the focus areas for AI as far as national security is concerned? And we think that machine learning, deep learning, computer vision, big data analytics, robotics, high performance computing, remote sensing, AI-based cybersecurity, expert system, and automatic diagnosis system are such areas which should be pursued, okay, for national security. Now, AI in PIAS, just to give you what PIAS has been doing as far as AI is concerned. AI research at PIAS. PIAS has experts and labs related to AI. AI-related teaching and research activities are carried out for the last 18 years. And in total, we have 11 AI experts in PIAS, mainly Department of Computer and Information Sciences, as well as Department of Electrical Engineering is working on AI-related projects. Some of the AI-related labs in PIAS, like Pattern Recognition Lab, Signal and Image Processing Lab, Robotics Lab, Data Science Lab, SIPMA Lab, which is basically AI-based malware analysis lab, then Deep Learning Lab at Center of Mathematics, and High Performance Computing Center. AI-related equipment at PIAS, we have 15 high-end GPU-enabled systems, NVIDIA DGX mini supercomputer, which is going to reach PIAS, inshallah, in the next week. We have an operational 40 teraflops HPC, which is already operational, and the 200 teraflops HPC, which is going to be operational, inshallah, within 3 months. Now, AI-related research output of Department of Computer and Information Sciences at PIAS. Graduated student we have been able to successfully supervise, as far as the department is concerned, 22 PhD related to AI, 40 MS theses related to AI, numerous BS projects, and as far as research papers are concerned, 200 international journal publications, more than 200 rather, and more than 75 conference publications, 8 book chapters. Competitive research grants related to AI that we have won are 10, and similarly, the development projects that we carried out are about 8. We have also been teaching curriculum related to AI at PIAAS. This basically curriculum consists of MS level courses related to artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep neural networks, pattern classification and recognition, soft computing, computer vision, computational intelligence, machine learning in cybersecurity, machine learning in biomedical informatics, evolutionary computing, quantum computing. Okay, now I just want to give you a glimpse of the AI-based development projects that we have gone through as far as PIAAS is concerned, and we developed a certain system, automatic cancer analysis system. In this, we use transfer learning-based deep convolution neural network for detection of mitosis in breast cancer histopathological images. Multi-camera, multi-pedestrian tracking, so developed for indoor and outdoor surveillance and security, considering 2D information from various cameras and fitted at different angles, we can actually get the 3D sort of sense of that particular image, and the movement or the human beings are being tracked. Image processing for haze penetration, developed for aerial surveillance of UAVs. So if the UAV is taking images and those images are basically hazy, so this is an algorithm developed, real-time algorithm, okay, to remove the haze. For example, these are the input images and these are the output enhanced images. Geolocalization of a target in GPS-denied conditions. So how would you localize a target, okay, to develop a vision-based algorithm to determine location of a ground target. Then automatic defect detection for non-destructive testing. This has also been carried out in PIAAS. If we are able to detect the minor crack in a material, and that material or that particular component is very important, for example, used in a nuclear reactor. So if we detect that particular flaw, okay, so we can avoid a disaster by replacing it well in time. Then we have brain-computer and machine interfacing. Dr. Akhil, he just carried out this very interesting work, brain-controlled robot wheelchair using EEG technology, and similarly, real-time brain imaging for medical and gaming application. Similarly, another project carried out by Dr. Akhil and his student is automatic low-cost diagnostic system for retinal eye disease. Control of quadcopter, okay, this has also been carried out by Dr. Akhil and his MS student. And then our BS students, okay, from electrical department, and they took this project under my supervision, and Dr. Harun is also involved in this project. So driver drowsiness detection using lightweight deep CNN, and they basically came up with this solution and even tested it on Arduino processor for real time. Similarly, AI-based application that we developed for cybersecurity, like anomaly detection in network traffic. If there is an anomaly, okay, in the network traffic, so our deep neural network-based algorithm is able to detect it in time. Just to give you a glimpse of the literature that we have been producing as far as AI is concerned. So our review paper in AI has been published now. The journal name is Artificial Intelligence Review. It's a Springer Nature Journal, impact factor 5.5. The title is A Survey of the Recent Architectures of Deep Convolutional Neural Networks. This paper is becoming very famous, and even in this single year, we have about 251 citations of this paper. Okay, and many students are downloading it, and if they want to start from the very basics of deep convolutional neural networks, so this is a very good start for them. Intelligent watermarking system for protecting medical data. Watermarking, as you might know, is very good for security. So we have been using watermarking to hide it in the patient record, whether that is image or EPR record, okay, and the way the watermark is spread and hidden in the image, that is done through AI. Then wind power prediction, whereby we predict the power an hour before, okay. So in case of wind power prediction, the wind farms, they do not give a smooth power, okay, because of the fluctuations in the atmosphere and in the air, okay. So the power is basically fluctuating. So for that, what they do, they use the supplementary power, okay. But if we know half an hour or an hour before that what the power, the output is going to be, so we can very efficiently provide the supplementary power and thus give a smooth power to the national grid. Okay. So for that, an hour before prediction of power is very useful. So how do we predict that power, wind power? Basically, wind speed, wind direction, humidity, pressure, and other meteorological properties or features are given to the deep neural network, and it tells us that what's the power is going to be. Okay. Similarly, intelligent cascade control systems, this work has also been carried out at PAS, and intelligent control of nonlinear motor by Dr. Rehan from PAS. Now, we have been able to, thanks to Rector, Pro-Rector and Member Sir, we have been able to establish PAS AI Center. Okay, and this PAS AI Center, known as PAC, has three main pillars. It has to perform AI training of the students or other nominees. Okay, then it has to have an AI research, and then it also has HPC, the high power computing. Okay. So with this, thanks. I would also like to have question maybe at the end, because two of my PhD students, Anavia Sohail and Saddam Hussein, are going to present their specific task related to AI. Okay, so first I invite Anavia to just carry on and give you a specific talk related to her project, which is...
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. I'm Engineer Saddam Hussein Khan. My supervisor, Dr. Asiapullah Khan. Our presentation topic is relevant to COVID-19 detection and diagnosis system using chest X-ray and CT lungs images and deep learning. As you know that COVID is spread throughout the world and it affects almost more than 200 of countries and in fact more than 80 million of people, and it caused 16 million of people are caused death. So early diagnostic system, early detection system, very important in order to prevent such a disease. So what cause it, which cause it causes? It causes respiratory illnesses, it means exchange of gases between the blood and water and other air. So it affects our whole respiratory system and it causes death due to the failure of respiratory system. And what is the common medium of a common infection of the COVID? That is due to the cough, sneezing and talking. So the clinical symptoms, their most common symptoms of clinical symptoms are fever, dry cough, and while in a severest case, it may cause pneumonia and other infection. So we need immediate detection because in order to prevent the we need a quick detection system in order to prevent the COVID-19 spread. So anywhere who any there is suspect of COVID infected, we need to quarantine them, and proper treatment and care is very important. And after this, we are attending a social distances and reduce contact with this. Due to these policies, we can reduce such infection. Most commonly diagnostic tests are RT-PCR test. RT-PCR tests are early detection test. This detection test is when the virus is in active form, while when the in severe case it infects the human organs or lungs or chest, then you have to move toward X-ray and CT scan analysis where the virus is active or in active form. While when the person become recovered and you are testing their antibodies, there is serological test. So in all these tests, we have seen that RT-PCR test will take almost 24 hours. While X-ray and CT scan analysis is a very tedious job and time-consuming job, And as you seen that in Pakistan, in just like in underdeveloped country, patient per doctor rate is very high. So it is very huge burden on radiologist in order to analyze chest X-ray, CT scan analysis. So we need such a diagnostic system based on diagnostic system. So we need automatic system based on deep learning in order to facilitate the medical staff. And our deep automatic system is based on the COVID-19 detection system using chest X-ray images and further diagnostic system in order to analyze the infectious region, how much it is infected, where is it infected, their cases, it is severe case, mild case, or huge case. So accordingly, this we can facilitate them. So this is the whole scenario, two-stage framework of COVID detection and diagnostic system. In initial phase, we have used detection system. In a detection system, we see that the X-ray, chest X-ray are commonly available in all of the hospitals. So we first take the X-ray images of suspect. Whenever it is identified, it is infected. The infected images or patients are further provided for CT scan analysis. In a CT scan analysis, we can analyze the detailed analysis of the infected region, where the infection and how much the infection. So it provides a huge facilitation to the medical staff. As you've seen that there is a chest X-ray images. In a chest X-ray images, we are performing some data augmentation strategy. We use data augmentation because in a medical field, there's a limited amount of data, and COVID is a new challenge. So therefore, there is a limited amount of available data. So that's why we are performing data augmentation. Data augmentation means to increase the samples. After this, we are providing it to the deep learning model. In a deep learning model, it detects that is COVID infected, that is non-COVID infected. Whenever it is COVID infected, it is provided to a CT scan analysis, that is CT scan images. In the CT scan images, we have proposed two main phases. First, they are infected slices. And second is analysis of infected slice. These are the chest X-ray images. So as in the first row, we have seen that that is X-ray images, chest X-ray images, while in the second row, the radiologists mark that infected regions. This is our whole detection system framework. At left, we have seen that we have collected a database of different data sets. That initial, that is, we collected 6K of data set, then 10K of data set, and 15K of data set. In a 6K of data set, it contained COVID versus normal images, while in a 10K, it contained COVID versus non-COVID and normal images, while in 15K, COVID, non-COVID, and normal images with stringent images. All of these are stringent images. We pass these images with a different validation and training split after splitting. Provide to the own deep learning models during a training phase. In a deep learning model, we have proposed our own three architectures. The first architecture is RENET, that is region and age-based CNN network. This idea is inspired from the classical image processing method, that is region and age-based feature extraction, region and age-based detection, region and age-based segmentation. These ideas is incorporated in a CNN, that is a novel idea that is incorporated in deep CNN. While a second model, that is split transform merge RENET, or split transform merge RENET, there are three different channels, mean there are different paths, and in each path we incorporated the region and edge base idea, and at the end we concatenate. While in a third channel, a third model is the CBSTM RENET. In a CBSTM RENET, we introduce the concept of channel boosting. In a channel boosting, there is auxiliary channels concatenated at the end to the proposed channels, and at the end we receive the prediction. And we compare our whole architectures with the existing state-of-the-art architecture, which is very competitive. And the competition is based on transfer learning-based fine-tuning pre-trained architecture and training from scratch, that state-of-the-art architecture. And their model is validated based on some measurement, that is accuracy, F-score, MCC, sensitivity, specificity, precision, area under curve, precision, and recall curve. So this is our proposed model channel boosted based split transform merge region edge-based network. As we have seen that is our proposed block. And each proposed block, regional concept of region edge-based feature extraction concept is incorporated. At the end, these concepts are combined, and auxiliary channels. These are the acceleration above you in a green and a pink colors. These are auxiliary channels, and these auxiliary channels are combined to the original channel in order to boost these channels. These channels provided for further processing, and at the end, it segregate COVID infected versus COVID non-infected and healthy. They are our own proposed architecture, the channel boosting based architecture, competing state of the art architectures, as you have seen that in the tabulated results. In tabulated result has seen that 98.53% accuracy with the F score of 0.98 and the sensitivity of 0.99 are achieved by our proposed architecture, while our proposed architecture is compared with the state-of-the-art architecture, that is state-of-the-art architecture that is ResNet VGG, which is considered to be the best modern state-of-the-art architecture. Here we have increased the sensitivity rate, and sensitivity rate is very important because sensitivity rate is rely on true positive and false negative. And true positive means true prediction. A false negative means the person that is infected, and you say that he is not infected, it will infect the whole population. So their true negative is the reducing of false negative is a challenging. So our proposed architecture, I have seen that it reduces the false negative in above image, that is we reduce up to 7, while in the second, for the second data set, we are reduced up to 14, and for third data set, we are reduced is to 31. And with the state of the art architecture results are here also, you have seen. These are the feature analysis of proposed architecture with the state of the art architecture. Proposed and a boosted feature visualization are just like it segregate, it make the decision cut between the COVID versus healthy, COVID versus non-COVID, and COVID versus non-COVID uncertain data set. While the right column show that the state of the art resonate feature visualization, as you seen that our proposed architecture correctly segregate or correctly make a decision boundary between COVID versus non-COVID. The precision recall curve, and precision recall curve is very important for the radiologist or doctors. You have seen that our proposed architecture have best area of, under the curve 0.99, while the precision is also at 0.98 area under the curve values. So our proposed architectures is competing with the state of the art best architecture, as is seen in the precision recall curve and ROC curve. This is the web predictor we have designed for the COVID detection system. As seen, this is publicly available and it can be accessed anywhere, any part of the world. Here you see that is a get prediction. You can take a prediction. Okay. After the prediction, it will ask you about to choose the file as image. Whenever you are choosing the file image, it upload that image and it will give the prediction of that is non-corona, yeah, non-COVID, and corona, that is COVID. Okay, it will give a prediction. This model is publicly available on internet. You can access, and it is on pipeline, like means multiple user can access at the same time. Second phase of our project COVID is COVID diagnostic system. In a COVID diagnosis, whenever the person is considered to be COVID infected, it is provided for the detailed analysis to the diagnostic system. And diagnostic system at the endpoint, you have to analyze the CT scan images. In a CT scan images, CT scan images mean it can capture, it can take the images of organ at every angle, So here we have also proposed two kind of strategies. One is segregation, any classification strategy. Second is segmentation strategy. It is because of that the CT scan analysis, all of the muscle, all of the slices are not infected. So in the first phase, we segregate the infected versus non-infected slices. Whenever the infected slices, whenever it is considered, these are the infected slices, these infected slices along with the labels are provided to the segmentation model. And the segmentation model is trained based on these data with the label. At the end, it predict that there is how much it is infection, where is the infection, and the whitish region give the information of the infection. So for that system, we have also proposed our own models, that is COVID. For the classification, we have proposed the COVID CT RENET, while in a segmentation, we have COVID SIG RENET. It is also inspired from the region and edge-based segmentation, region edge-based feature extraction, region-based segmentation. So these are the CT scan images. You have seen that the row A is the normal CT scan images, while row B with the boundary boxes are the infectious CT scan images. We have designed here for GUI tools that is publicly available. In a GUI tool, you have to take the load images. You have to load image, and the load images, you process that image. After the processing, provide to the detection model. Detection model will give the information that you are in danger, COVID infected. Whenever it is COVID infected, that COVID infected image or slices is provided to the diagnostic system. In a diagnostic system, it provides the full detail of the information, means a label overlay with the ground truth and binary slices, and with the original image also give that information of the infectious region. This, you have seen this from the images, the bluish will be the infectious region. Here the whitest is the infectious region. That is the second image. You have to load that image, pre-process that image. It will give the information of that is COVID infected or non-infected. It is in danger, the COVID infected. That is further provided to the segmentation model. Segmentation model gives the binary segmentation, as well as the label overlay segmentation, as well as an original region. You can also analyze that region that is infected. This is the normal slice. I see that you load image, you pre-process image, provide the detection model. Let's say that, congratulations, you are healthy. So this slice is not further provided to a segment diagnostic system, means further not provided to the segmentation. It means you are healthy, you are not screening for the next test. So these testing kits are available for the radiologists as well as for the public users. The COVID detection system is provided on this website, while the COVID detection diagnostic system open GUI source is provided on this website. Our proposed models mean our proposed systems take the each patient test in within 5 to 7 seconds, while the RT-PCR test is about approximately takes 24 hours, while the other CT scan and X-ray manual analysis also tedious and take a lot of time. These are the conclusion. Our proposed detection model outperforms the state of the art models with the measurements of sensitivity, specificity, MCC, PR. It reduces false negative. It have a good classification and segmentation performance. The detection accuracy is almost 97%, while the intersection over union area, structure similarity and overlapping are almost 98%. The proposed deep neural network based on COVID-19 classification segmentation are available for the research and radiologists through the GitHub. I've also provided the links of that system. It is quick and easily implementable and online accessible. So these are the research paper that these are online available. You in the detailed information, you can visit and download that papers. So that is classification region analysis of COVID infection UCT, that is for diagnostic system. These are the references. So thank you very much.
Okay, so we are open to any question. If there is any question from the panel, please ask.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. Sir, my basic question here. Vakar Bhatkar, Minister of Medicine School. Okay. Sir, mashallah, kafi acha work ho raha hai aur kafi achi research ho chuki hai PR lab ki taraf se. Main jana chahunga ke कुछ ऐसी फ्यूचर रिकमेंडेशन फ्यूचर वर्क कोई हो उनका तो काइंडली शेयर कर दें हमारे साथ सो दैट वी कैन मूव ऑन विद इट.
हाँ, तो अच्छा, उसमें यह है कि बेसिकली फ्यूचर रिकमेंडेशन क्या इमेज प्रोसेसिंग से रिलेटेड आप चाह रहे हैं या ओवरऑल जेनेरिक न्यूरल नेटवर्क से चाह रहे हैं ना, थोड़ा सा हमें जरा बता दें.
सर, न्यूरल नेटवर्क का ही फिलहाल जानना चाहूँगा.
हाँ, अगर न्यूरल नेटवर्क में आप आगे जाना चाहते हैं तो जो इस वक्त कह लें कि जो बूम है न्यूरल नेटवर्क में भी, या ओवरऑल डीप लर्निंग की बात हम करते हैं ना, तो वो डीप कन्वोल्यूशनल न्यूरल नेटवर्क दे आर वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट, और ये इमेजेस और कंप्यूटर विजन के लिए अच्छे होते हैं. एंड देन देर आर रेकरेंट न्यूरल नेटवर्क, जिसमें स्पेसिफिकली एक है LSTM, लॉन्ग शॉर्ट टर्म मेमोरी नेटवर्क ना, सो दे आर ऑल्सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर ऐसे टाइम सीरीज डेटा जिसमें आपको पिछला डाटा भी लेना पड़ता है एनालिसिस के लिए. सो दे आर गुड फॉर दैट. सो ये दो आपको मैंने बता दिए हैं ना, जो सब ब्रांचेज है ऑफ डीप लर्निंग. सो दे आर बिकमिंग वेरी फेमस, और उनका फ्यूचर मजीद इंशाल्लाह अच्छा होगा. है,
ठीक सर, थैंक यू।
अच्छा, और किसी का क्वेश्चन? आमिर, इज देयर एनीवन हैविंग अ क्वेश्चन?
सर मेरा क्वेश्चन नहीं है बेसिकली, लेकिन मैं सर आपसे ये पूछना
हाँ
चाहता हूँ कि डीप सीएनएन को समझने के लिए कोई रीडिंग्स वगैरह रिकमेंड करें ताकि हम उसको
हाँ
बेसिक्स समझ सकें सर।
हाँ बिल्कुल। एक तो जो सर्वे पेपर है ना हमारा, मैंने प्रेजेंटेशन में भी जिक्र किया, वो डीप सीएनएन पे बेस्ड है और बड़े बुनियादी उससे ना कह लें कॉन्सेप्ट के डीप सीएनएन की हिस्ट्री क्या है, सिंपल सीएनएन क्या था, कब आया था, उसका आर्किटेक्चर क्या था, और ये जितने भी रीसेंट आर्किटेक्चर आए हैं इनमें फ़र्क क्या है, इनकी कैटेगराइजेशन हमने की है, ठीक है, किस लैब ने इनको प्रपोज किया था, कब प्रपोज किया था, और ये किस टाइप के हैं, वो टाइप्स भी हमने उसमें बताए हैं, कैटेगराइजेशन भी बताई है, ठीक है। तो वो द स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट वुड बी टू स्टार्ट स्टडिंग दैट पेपर, ठीक है। वो कोई 60-62 पेजेस का है, आप ऐसे समझ ले मिनी बुक है पूरी ना, तो दैट वुड बी अ वेरी गुड स्टार्टिंग पॉइंट, ठीक है।
सर वो किधर से मिलेगा, रिसर्च गेट पे होगा सर किधर से?
ये रिसर्च गेट पे भी है और कह लें कि मैं ईमेल पे भी प्रोवाइड कर सकता हूँ, ठीक है, और स्प्रिंगर में भी पब्लिश्ड है, लेकिन यह कि रिसर्च गेट पे आपको ना मिल जाएगा, ठीक है। हाँ, आर्काइव पे भी है, आर्काइव पे भी पड़ा हुआ है। ओके, इफ यू डोंट हैव एनी फर्दर क्वेश्चन आई थिंक वी वुड एंड दिस सेशन। थैंक यू सो मच फॉर लिसनिंग। ओके, और उम्मीद है कि आप कुछ ना कुछ खैर से सीख चुके होंगे, ठीक है।